So just a reminder about our discussion. I just realized we don't have our discussion prompts, but we've been using them all year, so we should be remembering them. That one person talks at a time. Thank you. Thank you. I'll make sure you're settled. That one person talks at a time, that we have our eyes on the speaker, and that we try to stay on the one topic we can add. I'd like to add on, or I have a different idea about that topic. Okay, so stay on the one topic at a time, and then we can change ideas and talk about that, okay? So today, we are going to be comparing and contrasting two organisms, just two of the organisms that we've been investigating, the crayfish and the snails, the land snails. First, though, I wanted to make sure that we just talk about some of our schema or our prior knowledge about the crayfish. What are some of the interesting structures or behaviors that you've learned about the crayfish?
I think one of the behaviors is when you try to pick it up and just swims backwards fast.
So the tail flap and using the tail flap and being able to move quickly to escape a predator, huh? Yeah, that behavior is pretty important to help them survive. And then you had mentioned the pincers, and one function was help with food, right? Yeah. Did anybody, before we leave the pincers, did anyone have something else to add about the pincers?
Sometimes they don't have a part of it.
Yeah, we learned that sometimes they are missing a part or even might be missing the pincer. Mm-hmm. Huh. It seems to kind of retreat or withdraw back into its house, huh?
It like gets scared, so it like tries to zip back into the house and get more protection.
Yeah, absolutely, huh?
I think the antennae
It sure does. So it's using it as the senses, huh? The sensory for feel or touch. Similar to the land snail, huh?
Also, when you touch the antenna of the crayfish, it like goes back. I guess it doesn't like when you touch it.
So kind of a different observation with the behavior of how the crayfish uses the antennae, huh?
Sometimes when it when it goes, it plays dead sometimes because it goes like
this. We've noticed that behavior, huh? What about you, Angela? What's one thing that you found really interesting about a structure or a behavior, the crayfish?
That when they were on top of the house and trying to get out of the bin.
Yeah, several of us have been noticing the house, how there's especially one, I forgot what you named it. Was it Hawk? Mm-hmm. There's one that was in Group B's basin who gets on the house a lot, right?
No, A.
Group A.
And Group B.
Yeah, so maybe for some defense?
They get on top of the house.
Yeah, maybe for defense or even...
Yeah, they always go
on animals.
Yeah. Or maybe what we call territoriality, trying to protect its territory. Yeah. It's turf, yes. Protect its turf. What are, now let's just switch a little bit to snails. We've been focusing on snails for a few weeks. So same question, what are some of the interesting structures or behaviors you've been observing about snails? Can we just go to Alani and Alexia first, just because we haven't heard from them, and then?
The shell for when it's really scared it could go inside.
Yeah, so interesting is similar to what Alina said about the crayfish, huh? It retreats into its shell.
That's shell
as a way to protect itself.
Like when it walks and something touches its eye, then it like scoots right in
like the snails.
Yeah, we notice that the tentacles will retract. So it senses it. We had talked about the tentacles being the function is sense, right? Absolutely. Calvin.
I want to ask a question. Is that Is there any like snails that have like if they have baby snails, so that maybe do the papa snails or something, put the baby snails in their shell, in the papa snail shell or mother snail shell?
So I definitely want you to think of that question. We can definitely investigate it. What's your thinking about? Like, what are you thinking about to make that connection to the snails? Is there another organism that you're thinking of that maybe is like the snail and the papa and the baby in some way? Mm. What other organism have you observed that with?
I think so, but I forget.
Or maybe is it something that you've observed with our snails in our classroom?
Yeah.
No, I haven't observed it in our classroom, but I don't know. But I know I've observed it before. I think, I've heard of it or something.
I gotta add on.
You want to add on? Okay.
I've learned that a baby snail is as big as an adult snail shell.
Oh. So looking and comparing the different sizes. I do have.
We have some baby snails in our classroom.
We do. Yeah. Angelo, you can tell. I just wanted to give an opportunity for some people that may not have shared yet. And then I'd like to go back kind of to Calvin had said. But, Angelo?
I put my finger on the water and then I made a wave and turned around. It kind of felt it.
So having that ability to sense? Yeah. Are we talking about the crayfish or the snails?
Crayfish.
And so using the antennae, like Alina and Jasmine said, but also remember they have the bristles that they use for scents too, huh?
I still don't know what animal it was.
Okay. All right. Brandon?
Snails have coiled shells.
Yeah. And what's the coiled shell for? What's the function?
Protection. It also tells. Also interestingly, it tells if a snail is right-handed or left-handed.
If the spiral's
coiled to the right, if the snail is right-handed. If it's coiled to the left, the snail is left-handed.
It said in your Brandon, where did you learn this information?
From the book.
So that your evidence is some research in the book. Can we go back to Calvin's? Calvin had mentioned something.
I still don't know what animal it is.
And that's okay. But Calvin had said he was wondering about the baby snails and the papa snail, and that he said, you know, I didn't observe it with the snails in our classroom, but I have observed it other places. Do you know where have you made other snail observations?
Your backyard.
Can you say it louder?
Your backyard?
Yeah.
Can you tell them?
Brittany said, oh, in your backyard, and I said, yeah.
And you remembered? So just with the show of hands, how many of you have...
I didn't see any baby snails going into Papa's snail shell.
I remember when the baby snail went on top of the
thank you. I'll just wait. And you also have Miss Landis's class, right? So, since we have been investigating snails in both our class as well as Miss Landis's class for the last few weeks, have you been noticing snails more? I mean, it sounds like Calvin has either been in...
I didn't see that, but... I just think I've heard of it somewhere that something goes into something else's shell.
Okay. Marissa, can you tell us? You said, yeah. Can you tell us about it?
Well, there's a couple things that we've been noticing about the snails that, like, sometimes they stay in the shell, and even if there's water in it, and sometimes they jump. But the ones that we have in our classroom, they have when they're in the shell and you put water in it, they come out.
Do you remember what we had called that? No. I did write it on our word chart. The word was estivate. So say that with me.
Estivate.
And we'll talk a little bit more after recess about estivate. But estivate, we had talked yesterday, it was like a summer sleep, right? But Marissa, I can tell that you have been definitely observing snails because you brought in a snail collection for the class, huh? Mm-hmm. And Marissa, can you tell us a little bit about what inspired you to do that? Why did you bring those in?
Well, I was thinking it was unfair because you had to share, so I was thinking you should bring them in so, like, everybody gets one and they don't need to share, and they can do whatever they can do the thing once, so they don't have to wait for the partner to move on to the next thing. So everybody can stay around so you can just do it and then go on to the next thing.
And where did you collect your snails?
So my grandma has big long leaves, and we found the snails there.
Big long leaves. Let's talk. Remember, one at a time. And then, could I have everyone just scoot back a little? I'm starting to not be able to see everybody. Alexia, sweet. Thank you. Just so we can see Christian and JJ. Ulysses had something to say.
If you go down the hall outside the doors, that pathway, there's lots of snails.
And what's out there?
Plants.
Lots of plants, huh? Are they similar plants to what Marissa said? Are they? They're long leaves too? Interesting. It seems like you've been observing them a little bit more. So on the way to school, in our backyards.
In the water.
Absolutely. Okay. Natalie?
Well, I remember my cousin telling me after Sunday, which was Easter, she went outside to see if there was any, like, eggs left.
Oh, yeah.
And then she looked in the leaves where the snails were, and then there was an egg there, and then she opened it, and the snails were actually eating the egg. She also told me that the snails live in the dirt areas and the leafy areas.
Did she tell you why?
No, but...
Can you wait, though? We have some other conversations going on.
No, but she told me that her mother's calla lilies make great food for the snails.
Mm. And what's kind of interesting is Ulysses observed that as well as you, as well as Marissa, the long leaves. And maybe we could investigate a little bit more about where we know where to find snails, but is there a certain type of climate? Is there a certain kind of shrub or bush that they live in? Because you had also mentioned leaves.
She also told me that it's like a marshy area. Mm. It's like wet and moist at the bottom. And then on the top of the leaves, it gets really sunny, so they have to stay in the moist area.
Yeah, and like in the middle. That's where I found all my snails, in the middle of the long leaves.
So did you hear that part? It was also a... Can you repeat that so they can hear?
If it's really sunny and at the top of the leaves it's really warm, so the snails are going to have to stay at the bottom of the moist area.
And do you have a thought about why?
Well, because they would actually just get really hot in the sun. Because when it's really hot, and I don't see no snails on the walls, because it gets really hot, so they can't stay on the wall, so they just stay on the ground.
Yeah, so interesting. Something that we had noticed last week, I'm making a connection with, is we had talked about slime and how that when a snail moves, they make the tracks and there's the slime. Mm-hmm. And we had talked about one of the that was helping the snail move, right? Mm-hmm. So interesting is the sun... Like you said, if it gets hot, it might not be able to move as well, right? Yeah, it needs to stay moist in order to move. Okay. We have one more person we haven't heard from that wanted to say something. Lauren?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then it could potentially be hurt. Right. Or injured. Or a predator could get it. All right. Thank you. I know it. We're still going to talk about this after recess.
Well, can I just ask a question quickly?
Let me finish my thought. So after recess, can you scoot back just so I can see them again? We are going to be able to continue our conversation. So after recess, we're going to need to use all of our schema or prior knowledge from not just our classroom, but all of the places in our environment that we've learned about snails to be able to compare and contrast snails with the crayfish.